Hello, everyone, and a huge thank you for taking the time to join us today for our webinar on building high performance teams. My name is Dutchie, and I'm a managing director of SWAG here at Employment Hero. And I'm delighted to be joined today by our panelists, Kate Jolly, head of talent here at Employment Hero, and Sarah Mills-Krutilek, better known as SMK, who's the founder and head of talent at Pathmint. Kate, SMK, thank you very much for joining us. Perhaps I can ask you to start by sharing a little bit about your backgrounds.
Kate, do you want to go first?
Sure, yes. Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us. My name's Kate. I head up our talent acquisition function at Employment Hero. Prior to that, I have a bit of a mixed background. I started my career in agency and was working with really big enterprise businesses like Sainsbury's and M&S over in the UK. I then moved over to start working with startup customers. Then I relocated to Australia and I've been here for 7 years now, just got my citizenship, in fact. And now I've been focusing on in-house recruitment, initially for Expert 360 and now importantly for Employment Hero, where I've been for the last 4 years.
Hello, everybody. It's so good to be with you today. My name is Sarah Mills-Krutilek. I also go by SMK. I started Pathmint 5 years ago after working in realms like Tesla for recruiting at Tesla, head of talent at Twitter pre-IPO and at Dropbox. And what I realized when I was working in-house as a recruiter that there was such a need for artisanal recruiting, as I call it. So we really help a lot of startups and scale-ups with their HR and recruiting needs as a fractional people team. So I'm excited to be here today, share some of my stories and thoughts on what I think makes a successful organization.
Fantastic. Thank you both very much. I'm just looking, the numbers are continuing to grow here. I thought we had peaked, but we've got a huge number of people joining us today. So that's fantastic. As usual, we have allocated time at the end of the webinar for questions. With this many people, I'm not sure we're going to get to all of them, but we will endeavor to cover them off post the webinar and send that out. Please type your questions in the bottom of the, there should be a Q&A box in the Zoom, at the bottom of your Zoom screens. We'll get to as many of those as we can at the end of the first discussion. And as usual, this session is being recorded and we'll make it available to everyone after it has concluded. So let's get into it. We're going to start off with two quick polls. We won't leave these up for too long, so be ready to answer them. We just want to get a bit of an idea about the audience so we know who we're chatting to. The first question is, what is the rough size of your business or company? And I'm just seeing if I'm being invited. No, I can just see the questions. I'm not allowed to answer, apparently. So if you can let us know roughly what size business you work with, and then just so we can understand what roles we've got with us today, if you can let us know what best describes your role. So we'll just do that for a moment. SMK, whereabouts are you based?
I'm based down on the Mornington Peninsula in Melbourne, but I'm originally from San Francisco. So moved here to Australia 5 years ago. Yeah. I'm excited to go back to the US on Sunday.
On Sunday, great. I love the way I asked that question as if I didn't know the answer. That was so smooth. There you go. All right.
I love Australia, though. It's been a real delight being here.
Okay, so we've got the results in from that. We've got, looks like most of us are under 200. And actually, there's probably more in the 50 to 200 than we would typically have. And of course, we've got some very large companies with us today. So that's great. I've got to say that skews a little bit towards the larger end of companies than our normal audience, Kate. Would you agree? We usually have a lot more in the less than 50. So that's an interesting evolution for us. Yeah. As usual, our HR warriors are our biggest group of people attending today. All right, well, let's crack on. In terms of framing up this conversation, I wanted to start by sharing a quote with Steve Jobs from 2003. And I found this surprising because I don't necessarily associate Steve Jobs with necessarily being humble enough to acknowledge this, but in a 60 Minutes interview about 20 years ago, he said, "Great things in business are never done by one person. They're done by a team of people." And in that discussion, I think he went on to describe the balance that the Beatles achieved, and he felt that as individuals, they were quite self-destructive, but they balanced each other out, and that diversity of their different talents kept their negatives in check. So as we know, Growing a business has always been a challenge, and building the team that helps you grow that business is perhaps one of the most critical success requirements. Let's kick the conversation off by maybe getting a feel for what the current talent acquisition market is like. Kate, I might start with you. What are you seeing in terms of demand for talent right now?
Yeah, sure thing. We get asked about this a lot. So at the moment, in my opinion, it is quite a mixed bag. In certain industries and pockets of the economy, businesses are hiring really aggressively and going to great lengths to try and get the right people. For instance, last week, I actually saw that there is a tech company in Australia that's offering a $100,000 sign-on bonus for software engineers, which just seems extraordinary. On the flip side, we continue to see layoffs and hiring freezes at many other businesses, and that is both small and large. It's not specific to SMEs. I think interest rates are having a very real, tangible impact on a lot of businesses. I think consumers are spending less, businesses are spending less, and as a result, a lot of business owners are really challenging themselves to think about having a leaner but more cost-effective and high-performing team. So the focus is really on quality. How do you build that small but very capable and robust team? So think about having like a really high-quality all-star basketball team rather than an entire roster of American football superstars. Whereas if you look back a few years ago, after we'd kind of come out of that COVID surge, but like everyone was hiring and team sizes were astronomical. But at the moment, it feels like a lot of businesses are being more selective. I think for candidates who are job searching at the moment, that means it might be quite frustrating. I can imagine that a lot of employers are being incredibly selective about what they're looking for. And I can imagine from a candidate standpoint, it may feel that either there isn't much out there or that they've been declined for a role and that the reason feels very nitpicky, perhaps compared to what they would usually expect. For employers, if we look at that side of the equation, I know that there is a lot of nervousness about retaining top performers. So if you go back to that basketball analogy I just gave, it's a small team, you're really relying on every single person. And if you've got a Michael Jordan or a Scottie Pippen on your team, you know that there are other people out there who are going to try and headhunt that person, and they are nervous about trying to retain them. So a bit of an interesting market at the moment from my standpoint.
Yeah, lots going on. All right. And SMK, what are your reflections?
I agree with you, Kate. More the people that are probably trying to find those Michael Jordans in the market. We're probably reaching out to them. But for reference, Pathmint works with clients across APAC and the US. So we're working anywhere from two co-founders to, say, 100 people. We also work with companies as large as Allstate and Udemy. So for my HR folks out there, I'm sure you're feeling this. The past 4 years have been really interesting in the market. I know a lot of my HR folks are feeling particularly burnt out and stretched at the moment. And so what we're hearing from a lot of people in the HR realm is thinking about a division of their roles, because oftentimes you get placed in an HR role and it's like one size fits all, you're doing everything, expected to kind of lead teams and culture and DEI initiatives. And what we're seeing is kind of a segmentation of a lot of those HR roles, which is really interesting to me, having been in HR for such a long time. I agree with Kate, it is still a very, very hot market for people in tech, specifically for people with Python experience, Java. We're seeing needs for people with R, especially as a lot of people are really making a focus on AI. Even if they're not an AI company, they're looking at hiring machine learning engineers and people that have had some experience in AI, which obviously, as you know, is fairly, fairly new. And so there's a huge grab for talent there. We're also seeing a lot of moves back to just work flexibility. There are a lot of companies that really want people to be back in the office, but candidates are saying that's a deal breaker for me. So we're really seeing this negotiation between candidates and the employers around, hey, well, I'll take maybe less of a salary if I can work 4 days a week. So we have quite a few companies that are giving maybe three different types of offers to candidates, which maybe isn't really a cash heavy offer. Maybe it's a more equity heavy offer, or maybe it has work flexibility built into it. So that's actually kind of exciting and kind of opens doors to different types of talent. We're also looking at much more hiring in different locations. So just because you might have a company in Melbourne or in Sydney or in San Francisco doesn't mean you're just limited to looking for candidates in that area, which has opened up our candidate pool so much more. And also helping with budgetary constraints, maybe candidates that you wouldn't be able to get before. You can hire somebody in Lithuania or in India that maybe is just as great, but maybe in a different location. And of course, we're seeing tons with leadership right now. A lot of learning and development programs being built, and we're seeing a lot of reach outs to us about bringing in our partners for learning and development.
Bringing in your partners for learning and development? What's an example?
Yeah, we work with a company in San Francisco called Studio 5, and part of our Pathmint model is you get access to our lawyers that we use, as well as our learning and development partners. So we have an amazing team there in San Francisco that comes and does workshops. We just had an early stage startup that needed to build their mission and values for the company, which I'll talk about why that's so important. But they helped them knock that out in about 2 hours during a workshop. So we're seeing kind of a lot of one-off kind of L&D experiences there.
Right. And actually, it does segue into the next part of the conversation, which is if we're talking, that's the market that we're all competing in at the moment. We want to talk a little bit about the true cost of hiring. And I know that everyone has experienced the anguish of losing a great employee and perhaps some the feeling of hiring regret after you might have compromised and just accepted that person after a long search as the best you're going to get. And there's that painful feeling in your gut when you realize that it's going to cost you somehow, it's going to impact you somehow. So let's talk about that. There's the direct costs of recruitment, which I think we're all very familiar with, the costs of advertising. The costs and time of finding those people. But what about the costs around staff turnover, hiring people that often, and the cost of interviews and selection and all that, the costs that are often overlooked. SMK, do you want to start with that one?
Yeah, I heard this military terminology the other day that actually made a lot of sense. And it said that basically once you lose about 70% of your team and you're down to 30% of your platoon, you're basically ineffective at that point. So when you start having regretted attrition, it is definitely something to pay attention to. So if you aren't doing like pulse surveys or really listening to your organization, but then also actioning some of that feedback that's coming from your organization, that's usually where I recommend people start, especially founders that maybe haven't thought about that before. Especially for early stage startups and scale-ups, you're focused on getting sales, you're focused on getting your product to the market. So HR and acquisition is kind of an afterthought for a lot of companies. But once you start losing people, you really want to pay attention. So of course, there's that new time to ramp up employees. It could take anywhere from 3 months to a year, depending on the role, to get somebody on board. And then you're thinking about that departing employee. If somebody is leaving and maybe they have like a 3 month notice period or even a 2 week notice period, you lose that productivity throughout your organization there. And so some of the things that we recommend to our companies when we're thinking about that regretted attrition is going, what are some of the things that we could really offer our employees that maybe are unique or different that really set us apart? And so we can definitely talk about like what that looks like, I think, in the next few questions.
Yeah, I definitely think it's worth recognizing that different horses for different courses for different horses. And there isn't a one size fits all. So some of the things we'll be talking about in the balance of this conversation, it's not like taking one of those and trying to apply it to your entire team. It's about trying to find the right solution for individuals within your team. Kate, do you want to pick up that thought process?
Yeah, second everything that SMK said. I think productivity is a huge one in the current environment. You remember I said that businesses are focused on keeping very lean teams and getting maximum capacity out of that cohort. That effectively means that there is no spare capacity within the team. And when someone leaves, their work has to be absorbed by someone else within the team. And that can wreak absolute havoc if you're running a really lean team at your organization. You then add in the fact that it's probably going to take 4 weeks to find someone. If you use a tool like Smart Match, it might be quicker. Maybe you can shave a couple of weeks off. But they also then have a four-week notice period, typically, if not longer. And then they also need at least 4 weeks to ramp up, depending on the level of seniority of the role. So That's a huge one is productivity, and I think people can sometimes underestimate it. The other factor that's often forgotten is team cadence. So when you have a team that knows each other well, they've got that kind of established pattern of working and behaviors, and they will churn through work much more quickly and effectively. When someone new joins, it takes a bit of time to really establish that cadence. So I think my high level summary would be, in many cases, high turnover really equates to lower business velocity.
Yeah, there's a lot in that. I think we should try and unpack some of the things we've covered. I guess in terms of the exiting employee, SMK, you talked about that, the loss of productivity, the ramp up time, Kate, you picked up on, but it's not just the ramp up time of the individual that you've employed. It's all the people around that, from HR to their supervisor to their colleagues, that actually is spent investing in that new person. You lose all that corporate memory, you lose all those customer relationships, the knowledge of open cases, the knowledge of the last line of code. And that interruption just can't be underestimated. In terms of continuity, have you guys seen any great solutions that really stand out in terms of when there is disruption to the team, when there is a loss of key people, any great tips or tools to try and maintain that continuity?
Yeah. I used to run our onboarding program at Twitter, now X, but I still think of it as Twitter. And I think what was great about that onboarding program is that we always assigned onboarding buddies that actually really had nothing to do with that person's function. And they were really like the culture keepers of the organization and helped to kind of tell that story about what it was going to be like working at Twitter. And what we found through that program was that a lot of people felt like they had some autonomy. And so that when one person left, didn't fully rock the boat, like somebody still felt like they were a culture keeper of that organization, as we would call it. And we found that to be really effective as we were hiring a ton of people very rapidly because we needed everybody to kind of be on board with the mission, the values. And then everybody kind of would choose a value that really resonated with them. And in fact, we'd have it like on a t-shirt, or we'd have it on our laptop sticker, like that's my value. And what we found was that we had an entire organization that really represented that. So that was a great way to kind of like keep the culture alive. As far as actually keeping the work going, it's really, really important if you're leading a team and you know somebody is leaving or working with that hiring manager to ask them, like, what is the continuity plan? What are the things that this person absolutely needs to share with the team? What are passwords that this person has? What are websites they go to for specific information? All of those things should be passed along throughout a process. I'm not a huge fan of exit interviews. I think you can get a little bit of information from it. I know some HR folks may say, oh, they're super helpful. But I think they're, depending on the situation and how somebody is leaving, you may not always get the best information from an exit interview.
Yeah. Kate, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, so we have a very strong culture of documentation at EH. So we use a hell of a lot of Confluence. I know that some other organizations use Notion. We really try and get into the habit of everyone documenting what they're working on and what stage they're at, so that there is complete visibility over who owns what and what stage something is at. I think that's particularly helpful for the product and engineering side of our business, where, for example, if someone moves squads, someone else that's filling their shoes can still quite quickly pick up on where that person left off. It's not a perfect solution. There are definitely limitations to it. When someone joins the business, they still need to get used to how we operate, our preference for different ways of working. But I think it's at least a good starting point. So if you're the kind of organization that's not doing a huge amount of documenting of processes and what people are working on at the minute, would definitely recommend checking it out and perhaps considering it as part of your regular workflow.
Yeah, a lot of that, Kate, I guess, is very closely aligned to our remote first approach. For those people who aren't familiar with Employment Hero, it might be worth just mentioning very briefly, what is that? How are we set up? You want to just give people a quick insight?
Sure, yes. We're remote first, as we call it. So what that means in practical terms is that we have a lot of heroes based in a lot of different locations. So last time I checked, we have employees in more than 20 different countries. And even within those countries, they'll be in different spots. So we'll have some people in Melbourne and some people in Sydney, as one example. So almost all of our team work exclusively from home rather than being in a hub or in an office. And we've also got people in different time zones. So in order to make that effective, there are several different things that we've been focused on over the last few years and leaning towards asynchronous communication where it's appropriate is a large part of that. If you have to get on a synchronous Zoom call every time a decision needs to be made and everyone's in different time zones, that can slow you down massively. And it also makes it really difficult for other people that weren't on the meeting to get visibility of what was discussed. So Confluence, Slack, of course, we still have meetings. Of course, we still have synchronous chats, but it's really helped in general to have that documentation piece.
That's probably, in my mind, the biggest practical change from when we abandoned, we did away with our offices. So not only do we have people in over 20 countries, we don't have offices. We actually have two, but they're voluntary and not many people turn up. Most people are very comfortable now working asynchronously from home. There was a question there from, I think it's Alicia. So thank you for the question. What was the program you mentioned to document? I think you mentioned Confluence. Do you want to just expand on that? It's part of the Atlassian suite.
Yeah, so Confluence allows employees to create spaces for different teams and different projects, in our case, different OKRs. Every team member will have a space that they own where they can document what the team is working on, anything that the organization needs to be across. It also means, for example, if there's like a cross collaboration needed between lots of different team members, you can tag different people in it and they can own different parts of a project or a Confluence page.
Yeah. SMK, I'm going to ask you the question about tools, but I'm conscious I don't want to turn this into a remote work webinar. A, because we want to talk about building the teams, and B, we will be running another, we've run these before, we'll be running a dedicated remote work webinar in the next couple of months. So keep an eye out for that. We get asked a lot of questions about how we manage 1,500 people entirely remotely. But SMK, is there a tool you want to give a plug for at the moment?
Yeah, of course. Well, I mean, I could not have this call without talking about Employment Hero and how passionate I am about Employment Hero. I've used Employment Hero myself at Pathmint for a long time, and we've implemented it for quite a few of our clients. And the reason why I find it so helpful is because we can track our OKRs in Employment Hero. And that's changed the game for us because we can put two different individuals on an OKR together as like an assigned kind of 20% project. And then we can track every week during our weekly meeting how far we've gotten. So if you're not using that function in Employment Hero, it's awesome. I also use Employment Hero as an employer of record for my employees in the United States. And so I wouldn't have been able to have employees in other countries had Employment Hero not helped me with the employment of record. So I think that's important to note.
I promise the audience that was entirely, we're off script at the moment.
Yeah, I really do. I wouldn't be here if I didn't say, oh, I love Employment Hero. But we use, for a lot of our clients who are not quite ready for an applicant tracking system, we used free Trello boards, and they're really easy to set up, and they can be used in a way that is very much like an applicant tracking system where you can have multiple people on that. You can move candidates along in different cards. Trello is really great because you can use it for lots of other functions like you would use Confluence or Notion, which is also really great. Of course, plug for Dropbox. Use a lot of Dropbox at our company. But I think that other tools that I'm really loving right now, I'm not a huge fan of psychometric testing. I haven't been for a long time. We looked at this at Twitter and at Dropbox. But recently, I've just fallen in love with a tool called Criteria, which kind of acts as an ATS, but also is a great testing tool. And so the way that we're using Criteria now is after they get through, a candidate goes through a recruiter phone screen and they meet with a hiring manager, and we're interested in bringing that person in for a panel interview. We follow a 10-5-3-1 rule. So 10 candidates at recruiter phone screen, 5 to hiring manager, 3 to panel, and 1 to hire. It's usually kind of our perfect formula. Before that 3 go to panel interview, we want to make sure that we're testing them on Criteria. You can give them a skills-based test that's like based on personality, cognitive ability, kind of empathy. And it's really great to see what this person's real strengths or challenges might be. And it gives a really good kind of readout of what you should be asking that candidate during the panel interview. So if you're coming up with any maybe pink flags, as we call them, you can really drill down into that because the criteria scores have been kind of laid out for you to kind of understand. I always tell our clients, though, don't use it to weaponize against people, and you want to really make sure you have some unconscious bias when those scores come through. But it's been a really amazing tool and changed the game for us.
Terrific. Someone's just asked details on criteria. It's Criteria Corp, isn't it? Yeah.
It is. Yeah, we also use it, not for all roles, but for a good chunk of roles. I would guess probably about 60% of them at the moment we use some criteria testing for. The other async product that I would plug briefly, and my team laugh at me for how much I love it, is Loom. So when you do not have the opportunity to have a meeting with someone, but you don't want to send a huge block of text because it's dry and difficult really to get the message across, you can record a video of yourself walking through a slide deck or a document, whatever it might be. It's a lot more engaging, tends to get a much higher response rate, and you can edit them in Loom as well. So it doesn't, you know, you don't have to keep re-recording yourself if you mess up. So I recommend that.
I love Loom for training. Can I just add one more plug for MetaView? And that's more of a recruiting-based tool, but something also similar where it records the interviews. Obviously check with your candidates first before recording, but it actually pulls out every piece of the information, like information that the candidate answers based on the job description. So it gives you a summary and an analysis of how much that candidate spent talking. So you, if you're doing a recruiter phone screen or hiring manager interview, can spend more time listening and preparing for that next question, but also sharing that interview with your hiring manager or the hiring team. And it takes out the kind of small talk and you asking the question. So it really just focuses on the candidate's answers, which I think is incredible.
Yeah. As I said, we've gone down a bit of a rabbit hole here, and we'll have to make it a 2-hour interview, a webinar for that one. I have to mention the application that I love to hate, which is Slack. It's my favorite and most hated thing in the world. In terms of those of you who are clients of Employment Hero, the ATS functionality, if you haven't used it in recent months, has just gone through the roof. There's also a new super functionality there called Smart Match, which we might get onto a little bit later. But I want to bring us back on track because we've been talking about building high performance teams. There's a lot of questions. I want to get to those. But let's just talk about becoming, we know that building a great team is vital to building a great company. Great people, great businesses are built by great teams. We want to kick this next section off. I'm going to ask a poll just to get a bit of a flavor. We want to understand a little bit about how many people currently have a benefits program. And I guess what I mean by this is, we've actually got it in there. We want to try and distinguish between, hey, we have something that we run informally, but it works really well, versus we've got a structured formal program, versus we don't do anything around benefits. And you can interpret benefits however you understand benefits to be, because that's what counts today. All right, while that's happening, we'll get those results in a moment. SMK, I might start with you. You know, no two companies are the same. When we know that when candidates are looking at accepting a role or reviewing an offer, it's very hard. It's not like for like. Salary is important, but increasingly, particularly with younger generations, there are lots of things. What is it that makes one employer better than another? Why is it that I look around and see some business able to build and retain great teams, and other people they're just a carousel walking through the door?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm an investor in startups as well as an advisor to quite a few. And obviously we've worked with over 100 startups and scale-ups. And I think I've narrowed it down to the trifecta when I think about even investing in a startup. I really like to look at, obviously, is the product good? What is going out to market? Is it a vitamin or is it a painkiller? I always think about that as like, if you're actually thinking about making a move to another company. The other piece is, how is the leadership? Like, are they effective? Is this the first time that they've run a company before? Which is okay. There can be really amazing leaders. Maybe it's their first time. But really thinking about who they're putting around them. Are they bringing over a bunch of their friends that they've worked with in the past? That can also be okay. But you really want to think about, like, how is the leadership going to be effective maybe in 4, 5, 10 years? Because you're wanting to think about that company and all the chapters that they're going to go through. And then, of course, finally, like how well can they attract talent? So I think of companies and chapters. I was with Twitter from one of the very early stages of working with them. And we were just a small little startup with non-working elevators. And then we grew drastically. So it was like getting an invitation to a dinner party, I always say. And then, you know, there are a few people around the table, you know them. And then all of a sudden it's like a giant house party or maybe even a rave at that point. And you have to decide, like, are people going to stick with every chapter of that organization? Or at what point are you going to need to attract new people to that organization? And so when you're thinking about attracting, you want to think, is the leadership strong still? Do they have an inclusive and positive culture? That's very important to a lot of people. Are there professional development opportunities? Does a company have competitive opportunities like compensation and benefits? And then do they have really good reward systems? Because a lot of people, when they're starting to feel burnt out and they're not getting those kudos all the time, sometimes rewards can kind of make up for it. So that's really kind of what I look at when we're thinking about successful organizations.
Yeah, you touched on reward there. I might let Kate go first, but I want to come back to just the basic concept of recognition. The other thing you touched on there was leadership. I've never said this thought out loud, so I hope I'm on the track. When I look at Glassdoor, I find that it's basically mostly about leadership. And I don't know if that's the way they word the question, if that's the way people want to vent or whatever. But when you look at Glassdoor, it's typically about my manager or the leadership of the company. It's not about their colleagues or whatever. So it's a really interesting point you make there about the long-term investment in your leadership as a team building prerequisite. Kate, you want to pick up on this part of the conversation?
Yeah, so I think quite a common misconception is that it's all about salary. Salary is undeniably important, particularly in the current market, but I think there is so much more to it than that. In my experience, candidates all have different perspectives on how they want to work. So for example, sure, a lot of people love remote first, but we also interview some people who really like being in the office and they end up not being quite the right fit for us for that reason. So I think there's a lot of variation in what some candidates are looking for, but something that is common among every candidate, I have never heard anyone say differently, is the importance of feeling valued and recognized by your employer. So similar to what SMK said, I think if you're a small business and you're sitting there thinking, I can't offer remote work because we have storefronts, or I can't offer a huge salary increase this year because the market is too tough, my recommendation would be to focus on other things and really importantly, making your teams feel valued and recognized. So at Employment Hero, we do a lot of shout outs, obviously via the platform, but importantly, we also come together once a fortnight for what we call our all hands when whole company logs on and people are shouted out and recognized live on the call. We also use a framework called SBI, which stands for Situation Behavior Impact, which I really recommend. So if you're an employee and you're typing up a recognition for a teammate or someone that reports into you, describe the situation. So outline the situation that you're referring to where that person really shone, make the context really clear and specific. Behavior, describe what precisely that person did or how they behaved, and impact, highlight the impact that person's behavior had. It works really well for us. I think it makes the shout out or the recognition much more meaningful. I think it also shows others who are perhaps newer to the business who haven't had a shout out yet, what great behavior at work looks like and what it means to go above and beyond in your everyday role. So that's a big one.
Yeah, Ken, I just wanted to jump in there because I've noticed since you've introduced that format, it's just so, raised the productivity, the benefits that we're getting through our recognition by just having people see and follow that structure has been huge. It's amazing how those simple little things can just be so impactful. Sorry, I interrupted you.
No, I totally agree. We're really starting to see now and understand better when someone has been recognized, why and what they've done. I think it also gives people much better insight into what other teams are doing and what their colleagues are doing, even if they don't interact with them day to day as part of their role. So really recommend that for any listeners. The other thing I'll add is that, annoying or not, however you may see it, you cannot underestimate the value of perks. there is a whole section on Glassdoor that is all about perks, and candidates talk about it and compare their perks a lot. So if you are an EH user, I would really tap into our benefits offering. Just to quickly walk through some of what that includes, you've got hero points. So as an employer, you can use hero points to reward and recognize employees. Could be for a birthday, work anniversary, or for going above and beyond or living your company's values. Those points can then be redeemed in a swag discount store, so employees can access a ton of different items and gift cards at a reduced rate. We've also got a cashback offering, so they can redeem their points with a swag spend account, which allows them to get discounts and cashback offers on things like healthcare, groceries, energy bills. It's really diverse and the cost saving is actually quite significant. We also have earned wage access via InstaPay. So if you are an Employment Hero user, then definitely keep in mind how you advertise and promote those benefits.
Terrific. Thanks for that. There's a question about the structure that's been picked up on. Can you just remind us the SEI?
SBI, situation. So what's the situation you're referring to? Behavior. So describe how the person behaved, and impact. What was the impact that that person had? So make it really clear. When did this happen? What specifically did the person do? And how did that impact the business in a positive way?
Is that something that you picked up from external research, or did that develop internally? Can people go away and research that?
Yeah, you can go away and research it. It was absolutely not invented by Employment Hero. Like many things, we borrowed it from someone just as bright, or maybe a bit brighter than myself.
Fantastic. And so I just want to, before we move on to the details about reward and recognition and motivating teams, I just want to try and go back. My original question here, which I've almost forgotten, was about why is it that one employer can be perceived an SMK? I'm probably going to ask you to try and give us some clarity around this, just to try and bring together everything that we just covered in the last 5 to 10 minutes. What is it that our the people listening here that are running businesses can think about most in terms of, I'm going to be competitive on salary. I know that's a prerequisite, but what is sort of like the number one or two things that you think everyone needs to take away in terms of making sure that your employee value proposition is seen to the maximum value that it represents?
Yeah. A lot of my HR folks are going to probably agree with me here, because you all probably have these really great ideas and know exactly what your organization needs, but it's about really getting your leadership buy-in and letting them walk the walk. So you can have a really great perks program. You can have amazing food at your office. Dropbox had Michelin star chefs that really, we were able to kind of get people to come from Google to go to Dropbox because our food was so much better. But ultimately, if our leadership wasn't towing the line on that mission statement and those values and really leading from the front, then it didn't work. Like, you can be in HR and like have all these amazing things, but it really needs to be kind of like a whole organization buy-in. And so one of the things I really do when I'm working with early stage startups is talking about the importance of leadership buy-in into rewards, recognition, compensation, education, 20% projects, making people really aware of that. A success story of ours, we had an amazing client, Chronosphere, in the US, and they were a stealth company, not yet invested in, just kind of getting things off the ground. But the two co-founders really put great emphasis on the type of organization they wanted to be in 10 years. And it's so great to see them winning awards for now the very best place to work in the US, and winning awards for their efforts towards diversity, equity, and inclusion, which I know can be super important for a lot of organizations.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to stick with you for the time being. So we've now recruited this great team. We've worked around retaining them. Now we want to get the most out of them, obviously. We want them to be well rewarded, but we also want to make sure they're productive and feel as though they're striding forward. So what does maximizing potential of a team mean, and how do we go about trying to deliver it?
Absolutely. I was a very young, new head of talent at Twitter. I was really thrown to the lions, as I tell people, and had a global team, recruitment team working for me. And I had never had to have one-on-ones with individuals before. I really had a very specific way of recruiting that I wanted everybody to follow. And I realize now, many years later, that that was probably not the way to do it. And I could have gotten a lot better results had I followed some tactics. I was really lucky to work with our executive coach at Twitter, Kim Scott, who wrote the book Radical Candor. If you haven't read it, it's an amazing book. And she's got so many golden nuggets in there. But one of the things I took away from working with her, because I used to dread doing one-on-ones, was that as long as you follow the four C's rule, you're going to be okay. So every one-on-one that I have with all of my employees, whether it's weekly or a bi-monthly or a monthly one-on-one, I'm making sure to ask what I call the four C's. So the first is care. How's your wife? How's your dog? Are you excited to go on that trip to Europe? How's your move going? Ask them about things that they care about. The next thing is cover. What can I cover you on? What's going wrong in your world right now? What is something that I can do to help fix things for you and cover you? The next is correct. So you want to make feedback kind of a normal part of your discussions with your team. You may not have anything to correct somebody on, but you want to make sure that that checkbox is at least covered. Is there something I wish this person was doing a little bit differently? And making sure you're correcting them as closely to that situation as possible. So when it comes to performance review time or anything much larger, maybe they're going on a PIP, that you've covered that correct moment many times. And then finally, communicate. So what do you need to know that's happening within the organization? What can I tell you about this project that we're working on or any kind of development so that that person can do their job better? And I use templates in our Employment Hero to make sure that that's all kind of done. And we actually pre-fill it out before our one-on-one so that my team really has a deep understanding of what they want to talk to me about during that time. And so I think that that's really changed the game and how we operate. And I tell everybody, use those one-on-ones for your benefit.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot in that. I think I'm going to have to listen back to this myself, but I just want to press on because we've got a ton of questions coming in. Kate, team productivity and maximization, thoughts?
Yeah, I think an easy way to think about maximizing potential is when you want your team members to go above and beyond. So not just do what's required of them in their role, but really give that extra 20%. It's a concept that's typically known as discretionary effort. So it's that bit extra that goes above and beyond what is needed of them. You know, that craze that was happening a couple of years ago, I think it was now called quiet quitting, where it's like, I'll do the bare minimum just to not get fired. That's really the opposite of what you want. You want that discretionary effort. So typically what you find is that you have team members who are very engaged and very motivated. You will get that discretionary effort from them automatically as a result of the fact that they're really loving it and they want to do well with your organization. So the question becomes, how can you get them to feel engaged and motivated while they're working for you? I think there are a million different things that you can do, but something that is often overlooked and does not cost a penny is making sure that you have really visionary leadership. And we touched on this a little bit earlier. If you can master the art of really energizing your team members via your mission, your goals, your one-to-ones, we just talked about running a great one-to-one, the culture that you create, that's such a powerful way to maximize potential, or in other words, get that discretionary effort from people. If you are sitting there wondering, how do I know if I'm a visionary leader, or how do I know if my team members are visionary leaders? Firstly, what are your engagement surveys telling you? Look at that data. Secondly, how are the rest of your people metrics looking? Turnover, time to hire, all of that good stuff. And thirdly, I think just be really honest with yourself and put yourself in the employee's shoes. When you come away from a one-to-one or an all hands or a team meeting, would you feel energized by what's just been presented? And would you feel optimistic about the direction that the business is heading in? The final thing that maybe I will add is also not underestimating the power of your company mission. I think that ties in really closely with this idea of being visionary as a leader. People are really motivated by doing purposeful work. And this is a bit of an anecdotal example, but it's a very real one. Employment Hero is launching something called the Hero Foundation, which is a tech for good initiative designed to facilitate over 1 million quality employment opportunities for people living with difficult or challenging circumstances. And as soon as we started advertising that role and communicating that we wanted people to work on it, the amount of interest that we got both internally, externally from everyone was overwhelming. They were just so bought into the mission and what they would be working on. So those are perhaps two really great tips that aren't just all about breaking the bank.
Yeah, it's that the halo effect of the announcement of the foundation has been fantastic. I just want to bring it back and touch on the mission. I think it's a highly underrated or underestimated impact. So our mission is to make employment easier and more valuable for everyone, and that everyone we take very seriously. Whatever your mission is, it's not as important that we all have the same mission or we all have the same level of mission, but it has to be authentic. You have to mean it. So don't come up with a mission for the sake of having a mission. Think about what your business is actually trying to achieve. Go back to your founders if you've got them, go back to your leadership, go back to your longer serving employees and ask them, what do you think we do as a business? Why have you stuck around for 10 or 20 years? What is it that makes it important? And capture that, but then you've got to reinforce it. We talk about it all the time. It's got to roll off the tongue. And then the last element is you've got to live it. You've got to walk the walk. And I've been in meetings where people have actually said, hey, does that actually make employment easier or more valuable? Does that include everyone? And if the answer is no, it's a great way of distilling down and focusing on. SMK, do you guys at Pathmint or do any of your clients have missions that particularly stand out? Because I do think it provides the rail on which you can hang so much reward and recognition.
Yeah, we have an amazing client. He's based here in Melbourne Cortical Labs. They've actually built the world's first dish brain, which is a human computer with real stem cells. Look into it. But we sat down with them and built out their mission and values. And it was so thoughtful. And their values now are so clean and concise because they wanted to think about not just what's happening right now, but what can their organization be in 10, 20 years? And they really want that mission statement to still ring true. So what we did was we actually looked at all of the kind of great mission statements out there. We looked at Google's, we looked at Apple's, we looked at NVIDIA's, and really modeled what that looks like. So I think we've got a real clear set of like five values there now that now the leadership team knows. We can use it for hiring, and everybody on the team can kind of stand behind that. I said, print it and put it on a t-shirt. I think the first one is, the first value that I love that I would have on a t-shirt is everyone is a scientist. And it made me feel just like so welcomed into the community, even though I'm not a scientist, but I am.
Yeah. So I think values and mission, you can go away and have a think about that. The other element, I think, because we've got people here who might be in large organizations with sophisticated HR, we've got smaller businesses, people just starting. And for those who don't necessarily have bachelor qualified human resources specialists, subject matter experts, I'm going to give one tip here, which I think is perhaps the simplest simplicity to power ratio, impact ratio. And that is, it's based on recognition. And it is that idea that whether it's a work anniversary or a birthday, if you as a manager, a leader, a supervisor can start your day with one of your colleagues by recognizing the fact that it is their work anniversary, that it is their birthday, and I'm not talking about this is long before you even put any reward behind it. Just that mere fact of seeing somebody for who they are and recognizing that they've got their first year with you, that they've spent 5 years with you, that it's their birthday. That connection between a leader, a supervisor, and their team is so powerful. I will say that if you're using Employment Hero, you can turn those notifications on. And it's part of the subscription for most of the plans. I think if you're not using them, please, if there's one thing you do at the end of this call, go away and turn on your anniversary notifications, because it's the message I get the night before that says tomorrow it's Bob's birthday. And I can mention that to Bob during the day. It's so powerful. All right, we're running out of time. I've got a ton of questions. So we're going to try and move to those. Firstly, there's a lot in here about feedback, which I would say is either product feedback or support feedback. Thank you for that. We are going to make sure that gets added. Some of it is familiar to us, so there are things that we are already aware of and working on. Some of them are new ideas. So we will definitely take, even if we don't address it right now in the chat, we will definitely collect those ideas and add them to our feedback loop. Sarah SMK, I'm going to ask you, there's somebody that asked for the second C, somebody else has asked for the fourth C.
You got it.
So just run through your four C's again.
Yeah, please. Here are the four C's, and maybe we can send them out afterwards. But the first one is care. The second one is cover. The third one is correct. And the final one is communicate.
Awesome. And that is something that you've developed internally at Pathmint.
I took it from Kim Scott. Radical Candor is the book. Amazing book. Please, please read it.
Okay. And that was another question I've been answering several times, is Radical Candor. Okay. Kate, is there a particular publication, book, blog that you really like? Around team building, that is.
Very specifically around team building, not necessarily. I love to just digest and try and learn from everywhere. One of my favorite podcasts at the moment is Diary of a CEO. He's such a good interviewer. He gets so many different guests on. I feel like you can learn from someone in any industry, any walk of life, and maybe apply whatever they're using to your own business and put a bit of your own spin on it. So yeah, lots of reading, lots of podcast listening would be my own recommendation, but no one specific source.
Yeah, okay. There's a lot of questions around some of the tools and apps that we were talking about earlier. Kate, the one you mentioned that I think is being misspelled by a lot of people, is it Loon, LOON, that you were talking about? Was that which was the tool?
With an M for mum, LOON.
Yeah. So I even misspelled it. And that's the quick video tool that you can share a screenshot with. I also, my love to hate app, Slack, does that well. And Kate, what was the tool? Somebody was asking, I saw in here, I'm losing track of the questions, there's so many. Was there a tool that you mentioned in particular? There was. There are a couple.
Loom, Confluence, Notion.
What was your one, SMK?
MetaView is designed specifically for recruiters. All of the recruiters on my team are like, oh my gosh, where was this 10 years ago? So amazing tool. And then Criteria Corp for the psychometric testing. It's awesome. I don't even like have a channel partnership with them, but I think they're great.
somebody said, I missed the name of the program that captures interviewees' answers against the job description.
Yeah, that's MetaView. They're a European company. I think they're based out of London and fairly new, priced really well. I think it's like $20 a seat. Right. And it's awesome. We've really enjoyed using it. We use it for our meetings as well. It's fantastic.
Fantastic. I also mentioned that within the Employment Hero applicant tracking system, you can set it up with screening questions. So, and you can also set up within that auto disqualify. You can make the question mandatory. You can have auto disqualification. So again, if you're interested in exploring how to make your recruitment funnel more efficient, you can explore. I'd suggest you explore, Kate, help me out here, the screening questions, and then there are a couple of triggers you can put on it. You can do multiple choice, but you can also auto decline. Do you want to just talk about that for a moment?
Sure, yes. So you can set up questions when you create a new role in the applicant tracking system. You can create them yourself, but in different formats. It might be short paragraph answer, it might be yes, no. You can have an ideal range. So for example, if you ask someone, what are your salary expectations, you can set an ideal range that that candidate will respond within, and then it will help to move that application to the top of the pile, so to speak. You can also, as Dutchie mentioned, auto disqualify. So for example, if you have a question on your role that says, do you have full working rights in Australia? Yes, no. And someone answers no, it will automatically move that application to the disqualified pile so that you're not reviewing people who do not meet the basic requirements.
That's reminded me of something else that's so important in the recruitment process. And it's the rejection process, because Kate, I've learned this from working with you. Nobody's ever or rejected forever, right? I mean, everyone might be, they may not be right for this role right now, but you've certainly invested through your team highly in building out those relationships with rejected candidates. So making sure those responses and trying to give as much feedback, or at least even just acknowledging an application and thanking them for it. Any quick tips around, you know, how to handle the funnel of the ones that missed out?
Yeah, it's incredibly difficult when you've got a high number of applicants to give individual feedback to every single person. Just for context, we might get about 1,500 applicants for certain roles, which is just astronomical. What you can do, which is quite a time saver, but is still informative, is to let the candidate know that unfortunately you're not progressing, that there are other candidates in the mix that were a stronger match for the criteria, and then to actually remind them perhaps of some of the key things that you were really looking for in bullet points. So say, you know, it wasn't quite the right match. These were the key things we had in mind when we were looking at people. So it at least gives them some insight into what it was that perhaps their particular profile was missing for that role. Always volunteer to keep in touch. And if the person connects with you on LinkedIn, if you can, always try and accept and keep in touch with them for the future.
Terrific. Thank you for that. I've got a great question from Tony. It's quite a complex, it's a tough question. So SMK, it's coming at you.
Okay.
What's the balance between perks and having a culture of entitlement? And I'm reminded of our spiritual founder of the Employment Hero Group, a guy called, well, I won't go there, but he explained very early on that as you start to build up perks and entitlements, that you need to monitor this idea that they don't become, they're always special. They're always something special that people feel pleased to have, not something that they come into the office or start their day thinking that they're entitled to. How do we manage that?
Yeah, absolutely. We had this conversation a lot at Dropbox, especially because we offered world-class food. We were hiring the best Michelin star chefs in San Francisco to come and work for us full-time. We had a vegan area. We had...
It's okay. What year was that? Just take us back.
What was that?
What year was that?
Oh, so this was in 2018, 2017. I call it like the Hollywood of our day, working in Silicon Valley at that time. We really used food as a motivator to get people from Google because we knew their food wasn't as good as our food. And I was sending people to our Dropbox, like Instagram page, so they could see the food. We were inviting them in for the food. But then we had so many conversations about food. Our all hands were starting to focus on, there's too much salt in the vegan food. You're not offering enough tofu options. You know, like we want vegan cheese. And so it did start to get kind of cumbersome at some point where we started to say, hey, you know, you're starting to look a gift horse in the mouth at this point. And I think you want to bring it back to your values at that point and kind of remind people around, yes, we've got these perks, but at some point we want people to really be focused on what are our true values here. And so we spent a lot of time in those meetings being empathetic and really trying to listen to our employees, but also really tempering that with, let's bring it back to our values and kind of like what the true meaning of being here and working is about. And again, that's when your leadership comes in, having them toe the line on that mission and values and making sure that that's like a common thread that comes down through one-on-ones with managers and having those types of conversations.
Yeah. I'm sure that if we dial it back from Michelin star chefs to hero points or a coffee down the road at the local cafe, the same principle applies. I think if you put the structure in to say, this is in recognition, you use that structure that Kate laid out before to actually make sure people understand the situation and the benefit and the impact, those elements. I just wanna recognize one thing that's been added here is a great observation. Stacey says that they found that asking candidates their values is great for working out alignment with the company, making sure that the candidates are aligned to the mission as part of the recruitment process. I take that one step further, which I think she's implied, is that when you're developing your vision, your values, don't do it in isolation. Don't sit in a room with four of you and come up with them. Make sure they're the values of your team. Otherwise, you're going to step off on the wrong foot. Look, we're just about out of time. We've got a ton of questions. As I said, there's some questions asking for help about where they can find things in the platform. We'll try and respond to those directly with some support. There are plenty of suggestions around the product, our perks and benefits program and support. We take those seriously. We'll add those to our development roadmap and reconsider some of the changes we've made. But on that note, I just want to thank you both very much for your insights. It's been fantastic. I wish we'd had a lot more time. As I mentioned, we will do a remote work special later in the year and talk about how we make decisions asynchronously, how we develop and maintain cultures remotely. But in the meantime, Kate, thank you very much. People can follow you on LinkedIn for more tips and reach out to you. And SMK, yeah. Pathmint, I think the LinkedIn Link is there for you and Pathmint. Thank you very much both for your time. And of course, thank you very much for everyone who joined us. We'll be sending out the recording. But for now, that's all from us. Thanks very much.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great week.